Welcome to our Christmas free-for-all. This is Bishop Jill, the Bishop of Lancaster, and I'm Bishop Julian, the Bishop of Blackburn. Jill, what's a Christmas free-for-all?
Well, it's a chance for everybody to be welcome to a service that's for everybody. There's kids, there's comedy, there's a sleigh ride around the county, and we're going to begin our time together with a song. It's beginning to feel a lot like Christmas from the Octavius Choir. So with me now is Sarah Earnshaw, who's the Children's Advisor for the Church of England in Lancashire. Sarah, what have you got for us today?
Well, I am going to be sharing with you today how to make these brilliant Christmas ice fire bottles. And you can make this with bits and pieces that you've got around at home. So all you need is a clean, dry, empty plastic bottle, some rice. Now, I've used coloured rice in mine, but just plain white rice is fine. And then some Christmassy bits and pieces that will fit through the neck of the bottle. To make and lots of fun, and then afterwards, as well as enjoying the activity, you can enjoy searching for all the different bits and pieces inside your bottle. Now with mine, I've got some little wooden nativity figures in mine, and I could use mine to help me tell the nativity story. But if you don't have the nativity figures, you don't need to worry, because you could still think about different things associated with the Christmas story that are inside your bottle. So, for example, if you have a little silver heart inside yours, that could remind you that God loves the world so much that he sent Jesus down to earth. And if, for example, you have a piece of ribbon inside yours, that reminds us that Jesus is the best present we could ever receive. And if you have a jingly bell inside yours, that could remind you that this amazing story is something that you just have to share with other people. I wonder what's the story inside your I Spy bottle. Now, you will find more exciting Christmas makes on our children's YouTube channel, which is Clayton Kids. And you'll also find lots of resources for children to use and young people on the Board of Education website, which is bdeducation.org.uk. So take a look.
And now it's a turn to welcome Chris Kavich, who's the rector of Morecambe Parish Church, and he's going to lighten our mood with a bit of Christmas comedy.
Holidays are coming, holidays are coming, holidays are coming. Always the real thing, always Coca-Cola or something, always Christmas, always Jesus. Anyway, it's really good to be with you and to do a little bit more comedy of sorts. And I'm here with my penguin, appropriately attired for Christmas. Problem is, over Christmas, the penguin's belly gets bigger, as mine does too. But I'm excited to be a part of this diocese over Christmas. Christmas has been weird this year. The weather run up to it, it's just sometimes felt a bit flat, sometimes felt a bit different, but there's still some really cool stuff happening, and it's been fantastic to see what happens in church. I'm going to miss some things that are going to be different this year. For example, I'm going to have to buy my own booze after midnight mass ready for Christmas Day, because the heady scent of other people's booze wafting off the congregation as they sing carols will no longer do the job for me. I'll have to buy my own, which is somewhat of a shame. But I will be able to edit all the videos and keep the sermons clipped and short, yeah right, and to keep those errant soloists in key with the editing that I can do, or try to do, or hand off to somebody else. It's great that as part of this video, there is a chance to go on a sleigh ride, a winter wonderland, a veritable feast of snow and mulled wine and Sam Cheeseman. I mean, what could be better, I ask you? Except I believe there's no real sleigh. But there he is in his Armani jumper or whatever, in his beautiful shoes, as he goes to see what's happening in Preston at the school there, to find out what the nativity's like there. I even heard a rumour that there's going to be a donkey. I mean, he always dresses like that. But is he going to be dressed appropriately? I can't wait to see. Let's watch as they go on the magic sleigh ride.
And it is great to be back on our road trip, but this time it is a sleigh ride around the diocese as we go around looking at what Christmas in Tier 3 looks like. And a lot has changed since we were last out. Farmer Cath's calves have grown up. St Matthew's Burnley's gone viral, no need to thank us. And hashtag my furry friend has trended on Twitter. And first, we're here at St Stephen's Primary School in Preston. And we're going to look to see what lockdown, Tier 3, and Christmas mean for a primary school. So let's pop in out of the rain. Mrs. Wright has let us in, and we're going to have a little bit of a chat to her about how she's found these last few months and the preparations for Christmas at this very different time of year. So Helen, thank you for having us.
It's nice to see you.
And I've got a couple of questions for you about how you've found the last few months and about how you're looking forward to Christmas. So can you tell us something about how things have been? Tell us some of the positives, but maybe also tell us some of the difficulties.
Yeah, sure. I think when we went down into lockdown in March, we all kind of thought that it would be about 6 weeks that we'd be working with coronavirus. We had our key workers in, we were exploring ways to get food home to families, get work home to families, and we thought it was going to be a short-term thing, and of course it hasn't been. It's been a really long marathon of negotiating regulations, trying to keep everybody safe, looking after your staff, looking after the community, and it's been a really tough run so far. We're looking forward to Christmas because Christmas, like we hope it's going to be, is a time to think about a future of hope and a future of peace and a future where we can think positively about what's coming next. So yes, I'm really looking forward to a rest because we have run a very long race so far.
And what are you doing in terms of the usual big performances? Usually you would have some sort of carols, you would have some sort of nativity. What does that look like this year?
Well, the thing I miss most is singing and not being able to sing, because I lead the worship and the singing here. And so we can only have 15 people singing at one time. So some of us have negotiated that into our performances, but actually some of us are trying to learn carols using sign language. So we're getting around that one, because music is really important to us, and to hear those words, those special words of hope for the future and peace, is just something we just want to celebrate. So we're continuing with that, and this year we're going to be videoing our nativities and sending those home to families, which is something we've never done before, but it does mean that we get the chance to edit as we go along. So it's going to be a new experience for us all, but it's going to be good.
Brilliant, I'm sure it will, and I look forward to seeing it.
Yes.
Now, I'd love to speak to some of your children. Can you line that up for me?
Of course I will, yes. We'll go through the hall and go and see some of our worship leaders.
Brilliant, thank you. And now we're with Myala, Amina and Zoe, and they're going to talk to me about the Advent wreath and what it's meant to them. So, Zoe, tell us about what you did in terms of the Advent wreath.
Well, after I saw the live stream, I thought that I would also make a wreath, and I had to make it at home because from my bubble was sent home.
That's beautiful. That's really lovely. Thank you for sharing that with us. It's good that you were able to join in even from home. And that seems to be something that a lot of people are having to do at the moment, aren't they, with bubbles going home and things?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you very much. And Amina, you were telling me earlier about what the first candle that you lit in the Advent calendar stands for. Remind me what that is.
Hope.
Hope, absolutely. And you were all telling me about things that you were hopeful for. Myala, can you remember yours?
My hope for the future is to be able to see my grandma, Ab, and I am going to, because I'm going to her for Christmas.
Oh, that's lovely. And when was the last time you saw your grandma? Can you remember?
Ages ago.
Yeah, ages ago. So it'll be really good to see her. Brilliant. And Amina, tell us about your hope for the future.
I want to be a doctor and I want a healthy life. That's what I hope for.
Oh, that's lovely. And have you stayed healthy over the last few months? Yeah, brilliant. Well, thank you so much for telling me about the Advent candles, about what they mean, and about what you've done to contribute to them, but most importantly, about the hopes that you've got for the future. That was really exciting to hear. Thanks very much. Thank you. What's happening here then, Helen?
Well, we're standing in the rain, and we're having a rehearsal and some recording for our nativities and our Christmas performances. This year, we're doing it outside in our environmental area, and we're combining the use of donkeys with St. Stephen's Church, who are also filming this afternoon for their worship at Christmas. So this is year five, and they're putting together a performance about Christingle, and this is one of the songs that we've learned.
Brilliant. Well, let's have a listen then.
Why choose a young girl to mother a king? Why?
Great to hear some singing again. And what's been really clear through our time here is that the pressures on the school at Christmas in Tier 3 are great and are unique, and some of them are new. But what was brilliant to see was throughout, messages of short-term and long-term hope are still present. And that was really heartening. So now we're going to head off and see where our sleigh takes us to next. It's back to the bishops.
Also, you seem to be a bit more relaxed about being around farmyard animals and your clothing there, Sam.
100% polyester, Jim.
Lesson learned.
I've learned.
So welcome back from our sleigh ride. I am so amazed by our incredible schools all around the diocese, and a big shout out to our teachers and support staff who've been doing an amazing job in these challenging times.
And we're now going to sing Once in Royal David City, a great Christmas carol, and that'll be followed by our sleigh ride to Accrington.
Once in
I'm here now in Accrington in the Woodnook Centre with the vicar, Paul McNally. Now, the last time I saw Paul, we were on the cricket pitch together in the final of the Church Times Cup. What heady days they were, Paul. Yeah, absolutely. And how have you been recently, Paul?
Good. Like everyone else, we've had to adapt to the way things are working now. Tough, tired, but there's exciting opportunities about it, so it's been great.
Brilliant. And what I'd be really interested to know is how you find things have been in the local area, in Accrington, how things have changed, particularly since the second lockdown and now into Tier 3. What sort of things have you noticed around?
Yeah, well, Accrington already was a very needy town. There was lots of opportunities for us as a church to sort of meet some of those needs, and that has just increased massively over the last 6-8 months. There was a news article the other week, 50% increase in households applying for universal credit. So the need has doubled over this last few months. So massive need in Accrington.
Yeah, so those are really interesting statistics. And how have you gone about meeting some of that need?
Yeah, well, we've built on some of the ministries that we were already doing. We serve breakfast on a Monday and Tuesday morning to homeless, to sofa surfers, those who are struggling, those who are struggling with addiction and other things, and they come and they get fed and they get given a food parcel. That's been an amazing ministry to build on over this last few months. And we've been able to meet another need for families with buying them a coat. There are lots of families with children who can't afford to buy a coat, so to be able to give them a new coat has been amazing. And again, that's a ministry that we've developed during this last couple of months.
That's great. That sounds really interesting. Can I ask a little bit more about that coat ministry? How are the families identified? Do they come to you? And then where do you find the coats?
It began with, we were getting inquiries on the Facebook page, families moving into the area, other families saying, we need help. And so this was born out of that, really. And we've set up a page, people can buy a coat, and then we go and take that to the families.
Good. And looking forward, obviously we're in Advent and we look forward to Christmas. How is the church handling those occasions, and how are you going to worship through it?
Yeah, it's been great to be back. We were back Sunday, so it's been great to be back physically, but over the last few months we've seen how we need to be online. So that's been a real challenge. And a real blessing to us as well. So a lot of the stuff that we'll do over Advent and Christmas will be online to build up what we started there. We can't sing carols in church, so we're going out to the community, we're going to sing on streets, we're going to invite people to stand at the doors and sing some carols. We'll pray for them and hand out some literature to them and share the gospel that way. And our nativity, they're always fun. You never know what's going to happen. And this time we're online with various families involved doing that.
Good, and what's that gonna look like?
Who knows? The Christmas surprise, we'll see what it turns out like. I'm sure it'll be amazing.
Good, that's the joy of nativity sometimes, isn't it? And tell me about Christmas Day. How are you going to celebrate that?
Christmas Day is one of the special days of the year. So to be together at church, giving thanks to God for the gift of Jesus is gonna be amazing. So. We're going to keep it as normal as possible, being together, families as they're bubbled together. Hopefully we'll come along and it'll be a wonderful time of giving thanks to God. So really looking forward to that.
It was great to be here in Accrington with Paul and to see a church doing what so many churches are doing and identifying the needs locally, meeting them, but not losing sight of that ultimate hope and goal in Jesus Christ. We're keeping it local and we're off to Lancaster next for something completely different in a hospital chaplaincy. So it's back to the bishops.
So welcome back from our sleigh ride to Accrington. We seem to have discovered a new member on our sleigh ride. Do you know any Christmas jokes?
Well, I'm really worried about zooming in the inn this Christmas. And I've heard about those reindeer who are looking for herd immunity. What are your jokes this Christmas time? Have you got any jokes?
I'm not good at jokes, but I do have a favourite Christmas song, and we're going to sing it now, which is Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Hark
Can we just look at that beard again, Jim? I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, but I had no idea it would be that white. And that beardy, what an amazing beard. Loved it. Bishop Julian, you absolutely nailed the festive spirit. And I'm slightly terrified. Call for you. Anyway, no. I've always wanted to be side-eyed by Eric Morecambe, and now's my chance. And he can do nothing about it. I've always wanted to do that too. Bring me sunshine. Sorry, I'll try and calm down. But I can't calm down. I've seen Sam's jumper now, and I want it. Sort of. Kind of not really. I mean, sort of. TIE fighters on a jumper. I mean, Merry Christmas, the birth of Jesus, and pew, pew, pew. I am your father. But at least he's keeping it real with his furry cucumber friend that he uses. Massively oversized mic so that everyone knows that he's the host. Love it. I mean, everyone else manages, but you've got this, the giant mic. Who's in charge? I am Sam Cheeseman. I wish it had a lightsaber end coming out of it. I'm getting carried away, Eric. I need to draw it back in. We're going on another sleigh ride soon and I can't wait. I think we're going to the hospital. But wasn't that coat's idea such a brilliant one? Such a fantastic way of supporting people that need it. Sam, you could get yourself a coat and cover up that monstrosity as well. That would be a good thing. And can you imagine the slow sleigh ride, especially when Bishop Julian gets on with his beard to drive Sam around? What a flip of roles. Ho, ho, ho! Where are we going, Chaplain? I've got the mic, Bishop Julian. I've got the mic. I've got the beard. It'll be brilliant. Enough of all that. We're going to head off and catch up with Sam as he goes to see Ian at the hospital in Lancaster.
Our sleigh ride has brought us to Lancaster Infirmary, and you too will have noticed that there is no sleigh as part of our sleigh ride, and Jim and I picked that up earlier on, and a little bit upset, not quite as advertised, but we've enjoyed it nonetheless. So let's pop in and see who we're here to meet today. And we've popped inside to see Ian, who is the lead chaplain for the Morecambe Bay Healthcare Trust, and we've interrupted his coffee break, so sorry about that, Ian.
Yeah, it's just about forgivable, but carry on, Sam.
We didn't make it to a hospital last time on our road trip, so we're delighted to be in one now, and I'd be really interested to hear how things have been going for you over the last few months.
Fog, I think, is probably the word that comes to mind. It means, when the lockdown hits and the virus kind of entered our lives, there's a whole lot of kind of chaos. It's like lots of trusts, we went through a complete restructuring, we're putting on new wards, we're reallocating staff, trying to find our way really. And it's kind of been like that ever since, not quite as intense with the second lockdown, but you were always conscious wherever you go that this is in the background. So you can go on a ward and you need a mask, and the next one it's full breathing equipment, you know, a proper face mask fitting and visor and so forth, things like that, and exactly what happened yesterday. So there's a lot of hard work involved, a lot of tiredness around, I think, really. It's been a long haul, but people have shown a lot of resilience. Fog is the word, finding our way as we go along.
Yeah, good. And you mentioned a lot of tiredness, a lot of resilience.
Yeah.
How are the staff at the moment?
Well, they're okay. I mean, one of the things we've got to be realistic about this is that the pandemic hits, and it's not one size fits all. It's not suddenly everybody's resilient or suddenly everybody's collapsing. People respond differently at different times. Some characters find resilience, some people struggle a wee bit, and we all have kind of good and bad days. I mean, a perfect example would be that if you look at our YouTube program, our Service of Remembrance, which we broadcast a few weeks ago, you can find it on the Trust YouTube site. We interview one of our ward managers, Sarah, who worked on one of the wards that was hit badly by COVID early on. And she talks about the transition from being quite kind of easygoing about it to suddenly realising what it was like and the challenges that she faced. And that would be, I think, a good example of what lots of people have been through.
Okay, brilliant, excellent, thank you. And thanks for getting that plug in. We'll have a look.
I'm trying to plug my coffee, but you keep asking me questions.
That's fair enough. And obviously we're coming up to Christmas, we're in Advent just now. What does Advent and Christmas usually look like in a hospital, and how might it be different this time?
Well, the first word is frenetic, really, because usually everyone's saying it's Christmas, and like the rest of the world, we celebrate Christmas before it kind of gets here, and we usually are on the ward singing carols. We often join in with BBC Lancashire Sings Christmas, particularly on three wards where there's lots of dementia patients, and that works very profoundly for us as engaging with people. all that's disappeared this year. And as you can see, the hospital looks just like it normally does, really. And we've had a missile out this week about decorations. They can only go up, you know, 3 or 4 days before Christmas, come down very quickly. Got to be new decorations because we're obviously concerned about infection, spread of infection. So it just feels a wee bit tighter than it would normally, which is presenting me with some challenges because I'm now trying to organise a Christmas service. So there we go.
Brilliant. And what will that look like, the service?
Well, we learned lots of lessons. We did, for my first plug, our service remembrance, we did a baby loss service online a few weeks ago. So we're trying to put together some film packages and get staff singing and get a string quartet playing. And what we've learned is that we can put stuff out on Zoom and interlink with packages and get a fairly professional kind of product. So it's going to look something like that, we hope. On top of which, because of the Health Festival this year, we moved into podcasts. So we're looking at producing podcasts for the first few days, the last few days of Advent, throughout the 12 days up to Epiphany. So there'll be a short podcast each day.
I think how we find Ian has been typical of the people that we have met today. And who actually, if you think back to that road trip we met previously, people understanding that there are difficulties, but particularly at this season, that there is hope. And we have found them to be excited and willing, and we have found them to be full of that hope that comes from knowing Jesus Christ. So thanks for allowing me and for allowing Jim to go on another road trip on a sleigh ride. And it's back for the last time to you by the Christmas tree.
Well, welcome back from the sleigh ride. We've got some amazing key workers in all sorts of places all around the diocese, not just in our hospitals, but also in our churches. So Jill, what do we have to hear now?
So we're going to hear a story from one of our estate churches, and then we're going to go to our colleague Bishop Philip, who's safe and warm at home, and he's going to give us a talk about Christmas.
Hello, my name's Kathy. I lived in South Africa for a number of years, and I decided I wanted to go to church. So I went along and I found that I was not welcomed at all. And then I moved to England, have been in England 30 years, and recently discovered pop-up church in Highcroft and have found Jesus and made some fantastic Christian friends. I have found that since I was introduced to pop-up church, I have had a longing and hunger to learn more about Jesus, and I have partaked in Empower and leadership courses and various other programs to do with learning about Jesus, Bible study groups, and I am enjoying it so much because I just love learning about Jesus and how he can fill your life with so much blessing and hunger for him.
Happy Christmas! I wonder how many times you'll be hearing or saying those words over the next few days. What do they mean, though? What will you be wishing your friends and families when you say Happy Christmas? Well, for most people, the answer is usually perfectly obvious. A Happy Christmas means loads of presents. It means plenty of time with family and friends. It means parties and food and drink and lively music. It means a few days off school or work and time to relax. The trouble is, in 2020, because of the pandemic restrictions, most of those ingredients of a Happy Christmas have been taken away from us. This year, families can't mix in the way they'd like to. Most of the parties have been cancelled. We can't go out to pubs or restaurants like we're used to. There'll be no kissing under the mistletoe this year. And for some people, Christmas will be downright stressful. Maybe they'll be on their own all Christmas. Or maybe they'll be worried about the future of their jobs or their financial well-being into the new year. So what does it mean then, in 2020, to say Happy Christmas? Well, I think the Bible answers that question for us. So let me read to you from St Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, beginning at verse 15. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying which had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary kept all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. The shepherds went back rejoicing. They found happiness, and they did so by looking into the manger and seeing the child Jesus. So this Christmas, if you want a happiness that lasts, look into the manger and gaze upon the child Jesus. Because what will you see there? Well, yes, a human being, yes, a child, but so much more than a child. Think of the circumstances of this child's birth. The Virgin hearing the extraordinary message, the wise men with their gifts. Think of the life that child would lead, the healings, the teaching, the miracles, the dying and the rising. This child is God. That's the great Christian claim. This child, Jesus, is God amongst us. And if you believe in that in your heart, then everything about your life is changed and you can find a happiness that nothing in all this world can ever take away from us. If this child is God, then God has come to share in our life. And if God has come to share in our life, then we can share in God's life. That's the amazing claim of Christmas. We ordinary men and women, boys and girls, made from the dust of the earth, because of this birth, we can share in the life of heaven. And that means everything is changed. Everything about our lives is transformed. If Jesus is God, then in Jesus we can find safety. Because Jesus will always stay close and love those for whom he's been born. We're safe in him forever, regardless of what a pandemic might bring. In Jesus we can find purpose. Because as we follow him, we see that he has a plan for our lives. And in Jesus, we can find eternity, because his promises to us are forever. Happy Christmas. I hope you have a really happy Christmas this year, and I hope you find that happiness as you gaze into the manger and look upon the child Jesus, and there behold your Lord and your God, because in trusting him, we find eternity. So happy Christmas.
So one of the ways of having the happiest Christmas is to invite Jesus into our hearts. He's always with us, and it's a very simple thing to do, just to say, at this Christmas, Jesus, I want to turn my life to focus on you, and he will come and make his home in your heart. It's absolutely worth it. If you want to look on the website, there's ways of doing that, but it's just a simple yes. So, Bishop Julian, no get-together is complete without some notices. So what are the notices?
Well, that's true. Well, there are lots of notices to pass on at this time of year, not least to wish everybody a very happy and a joyful Christmas. Thank you for sharing in this service. There are other things for you to watch. The Nine Lessons and Carols of Blackburn Cathedral is on the YouTube channel. And also there's a Blue Christmas YouTube service for those for whom this year has been particularly difficult and sad. Do take advantage of that. And then if you wanted to find out what's happening in your local area, at your local church, go to achurchnearyou.com, and that'll give you all the information that you need. And so as we gather all our thoughts together at the end of this Christmas free-for-all, we're going to sing O Come All Ye Faithful, an invitation to all people to come and offer their worship to Jesus Christ, the new-born King. So we conclude this Christmas free-for-all as we put ourselves in that place where we ask for God to bless us and those we love and those for whom we pray. God, our Father, we thank you for this glorious and wonderful Christmas season. Thank you that you visited this world in coming in the form of your Son and for him giving his life that we might know forgiveness and peace with you. And to that end, we ask for your blessing, that of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, to rest upon us, those we love, and those for whom we pray this Christmas time, and also forevermore. Amen.